j'ai une petite question qui est un peu hors du cours, je peux commencer par ça. Okay. Good morning. So, yeah, so some people are still coming, but anyway, I have a quick question to start with something I didn't do yesterday, but to be sure you all understand. So I have a quick. You all know, I guess, what is a Bell state. So it's HV photons plus VH. And so there's two questions: how many modes and how many photons. Well, one is easier than the other one, huh, but. So let's start with how many photons. Yeah, I got a good answer in the first row, but someone is cheating, he knows. So I guess you all know it's two photons, because there's one going in each direction. Then how many modes? So I have two here, I have four here. Okay, so we can agree it's an even number of modes. So is it two or four? Two, who votes for two? Who would vote for four? Who doesn't vote? So, if you have your source of EPR states, this is V, this is H. So you have two polarization each direction. So this is indeed four modes. So you should never forget that this writing is in fact very, very bad. So the states is something like that. If you write it with the notation I used yesterday, it's 1, I have to be careful, 0, 0, 1, plus 0, 1, 1, 0. Where this is Alice and Bob, the usual Alice and Bob side, and here you have H, V, H, V, H, V. Okay. So that's one of the reasons we do this kind of things. Never forget that the Bell state is a four modes state. And if you So this morning lecture will still be a bit like yesterday, a bit formal, because there's a lot of concepts to introduce. And I guess this afternoon, depending on time, it will be a bit more seminar-like to show some experiments and what can be done with this. And again, as introductions, your background here are very different from this kind of field. So some know that very well already, some have never heard of it. So please do stop me if something is not clear. I'm happy to take more time, and if we don't finish, we don't finish, that's what it is. Okay, so another way to represent quantum states is not through the annihilation operators, but is through new operators that we name well, quadrature operators. So, and in fact, I didn't write even the word. I thought it was on the slide, sorry. So this Q and P, I forgot to actually write the word. This is too small. Okay, so these are quadrature operators. And finally, they are quite simple. These are the real and imaginary part of the complex electric field. So by essence, they are real operators. So they are, and they are in fact observable. Okay. So then you can define them slightly differently. I mean, to go back from here to here, you can invert the relations, and you see that Q is the sum of A and A dagger, and P is, sorry, this is a mistake too. This is a minus sign, sorry. I did add this slide to have it here, but this is a minus sign, be very careful. P is I, A dagger minus A. I will correct to put them on the on the box. And they have a commutation relation, which is 2i. So they are very similar to position and momentum operator for a single particle in a harmonic harmonic way. And so they are the exact equivalent. The only thing which is different is the normalization or the dimensions. So in quantum optics, we make them so that they have exactly the same dimensions. It makes things easy. And on my side, I choose these normalizations. So sometimes you find a 1 over square root of 2 here. I like this one because then it makes that the corresponding Enzermain relation is 1. So the variance of Q times the variance of P has to be bigger than 1. Okay, so it's an Enzermain inequality like you have for a position and momentum of a particle in a way. But this applies to this operator. So if you do a standard representation, I will come back to that a little bit. So this is a usual Fresnel representation of the electric field. So if you have a single mode electric field with a mean value, with a phase, which is here, an amplitude, according to these definitions, Q is in these directions. It's a real part of the field. And P is the imaginary part of the field. And what we will see is that, of course, this is quantum. So this is your Heisenberg inequality. It tells you that you have uncertainty on the extremity of this electric field. So this is a very usual representation of this uncertainty. Which is 2i, so the same inequality, meaning that you take this Q and P and you just do a rotation around here. So you can define this is all equivalent. Okay? So the advantage of this operators, so they are, and we'll come back to that, so they are called continuous variables because it's like X and P for a particle in a well. If when you measure Q and P, you can find any real number. Okay, which is the value of the electric field. So it has a continuous spectrum. When if you look at A and A dagger, if you look at the photon number, it's a discrete spectrum. So this is really the complementary thing. Really, to understand quantum optics, what you need to know is the quantum harmonic oscillator. If you know that, everything is there. You just take many of them, and you have everything. Then these are observables. So you can measure them. So here again, I think most of you know that, but it's better to say it again and to be sure we speak of the same thing. So the way to make a measurement of a quadrature operator is to use a homodyne detection. So it's a bit harder than to measure than the photon number. Photon number, you just need intensity detector, which has to be very refined if you want to be able to count photons. Here, what you do is you do interferences. Well, you do them in French, but it works in English too. Yes. No, no, really, yeah. It's A dagger A, which has a discrete spectrum. Have to be careful. Okay. The photon number has a discrete spectrum. The quantity you measure. Because A and A dagger, you cannot measure. They are not observables. No, no, but that's a good question. Be careful. The quantity you measure, it's A dagger A. This one has a discrete spectrum. Yeah. Okay, so This is quite easy. I didn't put the details, but this you can know. If you calculate, so I3 is really A dagger 3 A3, so it's a photon number in 3, A4 is a photon number in 4. So you make the interferences, here you make the difference, and what you get is only the cross term. So this is the interfering term, it's like a classical one. Okay, so this is what you get here when you make this I3 minus I4. And then what you do, you assume that the mean value of this field is much bigger than this one. Okay, so this one is a strong dominant term. And then you write it this way. So this is standard, it will come back often to that. You write it this way, so this mean value of A1 is a complex number, so a real part and a phase. And then you assume that the fluctuations of A1, so which are defined by AY minus its mean value, are small compared to A1. You have to be a bit careful with that, because this is an operator and this is a number. It just means that the values taken by this operator for the state you consider are small compared to the mean value of the field. Okay? Of course, mathematically, this is not very very strict. And then you put that back into these equations, and you keep only the terms with A1 because it's the dominant term. So you forget about the fluctuation of A1, which are small. So in your equation, you keep only the terms proportional to A1. And you replace A1 by alpha exponential I theta. You factorize alpha, and what you get is alpha A2 exponential minus I theta, which come from here, A2 dagger exponential I theta, which come from here. And what you recognize here, it's exactly the generalized quadrature operator I defined just before. So it's a rotated one. So what you have in front is the electric field in the local oscillator times the quadrature operator of the field you want to measure in the directions, which is given by the relative phase between these two fields. Okay, so controlling the relative phase between these two fields, you can decide, do I measure Q, do I measure P, or do I measure anything in between? Yes? So I just say this, I3 is A dagger 3 A3. It's a photon number. Huh? So it's and same for alpha. At the end of the day, detectors in quantum optics, they measure photons. That's all they can do. Okay, so two comments on that. So homodyne detection, to make it experimentally, you need a strong local oscillator, which is usually fine because the squeeze state you generate, and we come to that, are weak beams, so this is easy to do. And this field is single mode in a sense we have defined before, so you have a mean field which is in a given mode. So this here, I have assumed that these two guys are in the same mode. In fact, what you do is, because this is like classical interferences, this field will interfere with this field only if they are in the same mode. So what I do is in the same mode, and all the modes in here which are orthogonal to the one of the local oscillators, they will not interfere, and you will not see because they are weak compared to the local oscillator. So in fact, what does the homodyne does, it projects your beam on the mode of the local oscillator. Okay, so that's very important. Well, I didn't give the equation because it's a bit long, but it's easy to demonstrate. Homodyne detection measures your signal field on the mode of the local oscillator. Okay, so it's a mode-dependent measurement, and this is really a way to test your multimode structure of your beam, which is much harder to do when you count photons to do something which is mode-dependent, for instance. Okay, one last thing, which we should never forget, and we'll come back to that. If I don't put anything here, okay, these equations are still valid, but what is here is a vacuum, is a quadrature of the vacuum. So homodyne detection is a way to measure the vacuum. It's a bit of an indirect way, but it's really a way to exhibit the vacuum, and you will see that again in the experiment I will show you just after. Okay, one more tool, this is fine. Then there's one more tool I need, which is not that simple, but we have seen that a little bit already in previous lectures, is the Wigner function. So the Wigner function is a way to represent your quantum states, which is a bit more convenient than the density matrix, and it applies to a full set of states. I like to stress that the Wigner function is a way to represent a function that depends on variables that do not commute. And this is not only in quantum physics. If you do a pulse light, you know that time and frequency do not commute. You have a Heisenberg-like relations between time and frequency. And so it's also a difficulty to represent a pulse of light in all their time and frequency variables. So this Wigner function is called Wignerville in classical optics. And you can define like that. This is just for curiosity, but I think it's interesting. It is the Fourier transform of the correlation function. But I want to stress classically, you can do it. So if you have your electric field of an optical pulse, you take the Fourier transform of the correlation function at two times, symmetric times, and you get it. And it turns out that it's the same if you write it in t or in omega because of the relation between t and omega, which are Fourier transform of each other. Okay? And that's a way to represent your optical pulses. In quantum physics, it's less obvious. That's why I like to compare to that. But in practice, it's exactly the same thing. What you do is you do a Fourier transform of a correlation function of your quantum state. So you can write it either as a function of the density matrix, or if you have your state as a function of your wave functions. So we can look at this one first. And if you look at the wave functions, you take the value of the wave functions at q minus nu or at q plus nu, where q is a quadrature. So q and p are the quadratures. And you do the Fourier transform of that. So you take the value of your wave functions at two different positions, correlations, and you take the Fourier transform. And you can do the same with the density matrix. And it's exactly the same idea. So the Wigner function is a bit, let's say, involved mathematically. It's not too hard, but it is very intuitive in a way because of one property, which is the only one I want to stress here. It is this one. It is when you integrate your Wigner functions on a variable, for instance. So now I take the Wigner functions of my state, I integrate over p, so the p quadratures. What I get is the probability to measure q here. So these functions, p of q, this is given by that. Okay? I think there's a problem in my formula. No, that's fine. No, it's okay. So there was a problem. No, it's fine. Indeed, p of q is indeed this. So it's when we do a homodyne detection, where it's linked to that. When I do a homodyne detection and I want to see what is the probability that the outcome of my measurement is the value q of my observable q, it is given by the integral of the Wigner functions over the other variable. Okay, same if you want to measure p, and same for any rotated operators. The formula is a bit more involved. But the Wigner function is very concrete in the sense that it gives you the probability of detections, whatever the quadrature you measure. Okay? So it looks a bit like a probability distribution, but it is a probability only when you integrate it over one direction. So let's go to some examples. First, let's look at the Wigner function of the vacuum. So this one should be simple, and that's why I do that. So what do you know of the vacuum? The vacuum, you remember, we have each mode is an harmonic potential, where you have levels, and you know that the fundamental level of your harmonic potential, it's a Gaussian. Okay, so this is your zero state of a particle. It's a Gaussian. This is what is written here. Okay, if you take the vacuum, so this is the wave function of the vacuum. In fact, its light doesn't change anything. It's a Gaussian. But this wave function doesn't depend if you measure Q and P. It's completely symmetric. So at the end of the day, your Wigner function is simply a Gaussian. And when you integrate that over one direction, you have a Gaussian. Okay. So for the vacuum, your Wigner function is just a Gaussian. And this links to the representation I've done before of the Fresnel diagram, where you have, I did represent the state like that. So usually what we do, this is my quantum state of before. If I have no mean field, this one is the usual way of representing the vacuum because it comes to the fact that the Wigner function of the vacuum is a Gaussian. So we just represent the full Woodhaff maximum of our Gaussians here. Then if you go to a current state, so I didn't take time to define current state again. I assume you know. If you don't, please have a look in books, but this really I have no time. If you have a few questions I can ask, I can answer. But one intuitive way to define current state, that's all what I would say. A current state is simply a displaced vacuum. So you take your vacuum here and you move it around in your phase space. So very pragmatically, it means that you take your classical electric field and you add on your classical electric field the vacuum fluctuations. Okay, and so this is really what it is. So this is what it is here. And so that's why the Wigner function of a current state is the same as here, except that now you have displaced, so you have a mean value which is not zero, so which is Q0 and P0, which corresponds to Q0 here and P0 here. Okay, so this is the Wigner function of your vacuum. Good. Then I have one last state to introduce, and I will come back to that one several times, which is the squeeze state. So the squeeze state, and I start from the same Wigner function as before, so the same as here. I've replaced Q0 and P0 by the mean value of Q and the mean value of P, because otherwise they are not well defined, it's the same. So the difference is what is below. I change the variance below. So here it was 2, and now I have here 2s and here 2 over s. So which means that I change the variance of my Wigner function in one direction and not in the other one. So here, in this diagram, it means I do something like that. So I change the variance in that one direction compared to the other one. Okay, and I think I put Q, so this should be S, and this one is S. Okay, so in that case, S is smaller than 1. So a squeeze state is a deformation of a current state. So you have the same volume of fluctuations if you take the integral of the function is the same. So it saturates at the Amber inequality. But you have fluctuations in one direction which are smaller than the other one. So if you take a proper representation, which is a bit better than what I can do in the board. So this is an example of the Wigner function of a squeeze state. So it's a dual Gaussian in two directions. So this is three times the same. And here what is represented here is a projection, so the integral of a Wigner function along one direction, so which gives you the distribution probability to measure one direction. So this would be, for instance, the directions P. So if you measure P, you have a broad Gaussian. And if you measure Q, now you have a narrow Gaussian. Okay, so this is really your squeeze state. So finally, and then we'll come to that, but one we have already seen, I think, here, is the Wigner function of a single photon state. So one we have used. So single photon state, if I use, let's use another color, that diagram here, so now I go to one. The wave function of a single photon state is something like that. Okay, so that's the wave functions. Then the modulus squared, which is the probability of measurement, is something like that. Okay, so then that's why your Wigner function of a single photon state has to have a hole in the middle and a hole negative part in the middle, so that its integral over any directions looks like that. Okay, because this is true whatever you measure Q or P. A single photon state is completely symmetric in phase space. So this is the Wigner function of a single photon state. So I stole all this nice drawing from Alexei, PhD. So a few properties which are here. So this we will keep. So this Wigner function is a quasi-probability function. It's quasi-probability because it behaves a bit like a probability function. And we will see when it is a Gaussian, the Wigner is always positive. So it's really like a probability distribution. Of course, when you look at a single photon set, it's not anymore because it is negative. And only its integral is really a probability distribution. Okay, and so this is what we say here. And that's why there is some significance in having negative Wigner function. And we'll come back to that later today. But the main difference is when the Wigner function is positive, it behaves as the probability distribution. When it is not, it does not anymore. And there's more things you can do for quantum information, for instance, when you have negative Wigner functions. Okay, so now let's take a first example to do a little bit of slightly more physics. Is what is a squeeze state? I have many questions about that. So all of you know a little bit, but not clear how this can be generated. So I took this article, which is about the first one, which is for me the most clear one, on how to generate a squeeze state and what it is, where does it come from. So what they do in this article, they generate squeeze state from parametric down conversion. Maybe to be sure you all know how it works. So what they do, they have a creston, a K2 creston. They have a pump beam, so it's really like it's parametric gain conversion. They have a pump beam, and at the output, well, you still have the pump. Maybe I can. The pump goes through. Doesn't go straight, but that's fine. And then you have your squeeze state here. So it's parametric down conversion. You pump at 532 nanometers, for instance, and you get squeeze light at 1 micron. And I think it's worth explaining why this works, because I think you don't know, so it's a very naive approach. So parametric down conversion can be modeled by a Hamiltonian, which is that form, because you have one photon in this process. You have one green photon that gives you two infrared photons. Okay, so you can model it by Hamiltonian that way, where you have the creation of two photons in the infrared, and the pump beam, you don't put the annihilation operators because this is a strong one. You assume it's a classical field, so it disappeared from the Hamiltonian. Okay, you made a mean field approach for the pump beam. So this is really your Hamiltonian. The question is, why does this give squeeze light? So you saw the operator of squeezing the other day, and here I just want to do these quick derivations. It's not completely solid, but it gives you an idea. So then it's quite easy. You can calculate, assume that this is a time-dependent process, where time, in fact, is a propagation in the creston. You calculate the derivative of A versus T. You use the commutator between A and H, and what you find is equal to A dagger. So this derivative is 2G A dagger. Okay. Then annihilation operator is not convenient, so you go to Q and P. So Q is A plus A dagger, so the derivative of Q is the sum of this plus the conjugate is simply 2dq. Okay? If you do the same for p, which is I a dagger minus a, what you find is that you have a minus sign. That's the same equation. Okay? And now you have first order derivative equation. That's even me, I can solve. And you can write the solution. So what you get is q of t now is exponential of 2gt. So t is not very well defined, but t really is linked to the propagation inside the crystals. Time q of zero, so which is the operator at the input of the crystal. And the same for p, but with a minus sign here. Okay? Then, for instance, if you want to calculate the variance, so to have the noise, the variance of your q operators at the output compared to the input, but it's quite simple. I didn't put square, but this is really variances, so that's why I have a 4 here. So the variance of q is exponential 4gt, the variance of q at the input. P, you have a minus sign, so it's inverse. If you have a vacuum at the input, which is the case in their experiment, these terms are 1. So it disappears. So now you have really something which is of the form of S, 1 over S, the same as you have here. Okay? So this is really directly generates a squeeze state. Okay? So it's important to see there's an easy approach to see why parametric down conversion generates squeeze state. Okay? Then experimentally, what does it give? So this is from the original article. So this is how they did. So you have a YAG laser, it's a one micron, like 1064, which is frequency double inside the cavity. So you have both 1064 and 532 nanometers. Then you have a cavity. So this one here is placed inside the cavity. This is mainly because the nonlinear effects are small. So with this, you can strengthen the nonlinear effects. So your cavity is pumped by the green beam, which is here, and generates the squeeze light that goes out. Okay. Then you want to do homodyne detections. To do homodyne detection, you need a beam which is the same mode as a squeeze beam. So same mode with spatially, but spatially that's easy. You use lenses. But then also longitudinally. So what you use is the same original laser because it's a current process, second harmonic. So then you have a current beam, which is one. So you use the same original laser. You interfere them in the beam splitter. And you measure the difference here. So this is really my homodyne scheme. Okay, and then you have a difference here. Well, there's one experimental trick is that you measure. So there is a spectrum analyzer here. So what you want is measure the variance of your fluctuations. But you measure the variance of your fluctuations at a given analysis frequency. So you take the Fourier transform of your signal because you need to go in places where there is no noise of the experiment. So usually it's 1 megahertz, something like that. But anyway, what is important is that you measure the variance of your signal versus the phase of the local oscillator. So this is really a drawing of that, and it's the same as here. And what it says is theta is really the phase of the local oscillator, so it tells you which quadrature you measure and which variance you measure. So what you get is this kind of curve, where here you have theta. What is interesting here, even if you know, is now if I block this beam here, what I get is this dotted line. Okay, so I've got no input, I have this dotted line, this is my vacuum level. Okay, so it's a normalization of my experiment. And what is very nice is that when you remove your hand and you let the beam come in, if you look at a proper quadrature, so which will be here the name X plus quadrature, you will have a variance of the noise which is smaller than the one of the vacuum. Okay, and you should not stop to be surprised that you make a measurement here. When you add a beam, you have less noise than when you don't add the beam. Okay, so it's really a purely quantum effect that shows that you have fluctuation reduced compared to the vacuum fluctuations. Okay? So this is fine for everybody. Squeeze state, don't hesitate. So I wanted to say a small word about the use of squeeze state before we move on. So squeeze states are interesting somehow because they have noise which is smaller than the noise of the vacuum, so you can improve your measurements. So one of the first applications is for phase measurements. So if you look at the Michelson interferometer, let's call it this one, A1, B1, B2. So if I look at the Michelson interferometer, I guess you know that guy, I have light coming in here, but because I have a beam splitter, I should also take into account that I have A2 coming in here. And then on the output, I have, just to keep notation, so I mean, C1 is a beam going out here, and C2 is a beam going out here. Okay? So the question is now what happens when I use light, when quantum light, to measure a phase. Well, this is not very well aligned. That's better. Yeah, we won't get. Okay. So that's easy. Then you can write simply B1. 1 over square root of 2 A1 plus A2. B2 is 1 over square root of 2 A1 minus A2. Okay, so that's my first beam splitter. And then the second one, when the beams come back, I can write that C1 is 1 over square root of 2. The same, B1 plus, I will leave a little bit of space, B1 plus B2. And C2 is 1 over square root of 2, B1 minus B2. I have to check I put the minus sign in the proper place so that it cancels. It should be fine. So now, this, I didn't put Michelson interferometer. For instance, you can have this can move, and this will induce a phase shift. So this phase shift, you will put here. So here you can have a exponential, sorry, this is a bit small. I need a bit more space. You can have a phase, exponential I-phi, which is a phase shift induced by the displacement of the mirror. Okay? I assume that only one mirror moves. I don't care, so it's a phase reference. Okay? But let's forget about this phase first. I assume the phase is zero. So if the phase is zero, what you find is that C2, for instance, if I look at C2, it's a B1 minus B2. So if I take B1 minus B2, what I get is A2. Okay, so in the case of phi equal to zero, C2 is equal to B2, to A2. Okay, so when, and this is a classical calculation I did with operators, but when you take a Michelson, that's why it's interesting. When you take a Michelson, what you get at the output here, when it's well aligned, all the light that comes in here go back here, and the light that goes in here go back here. Okay. That's easy enough. And then if you have a phase, then you start to have a signal. Maybe I don't need to write it too much, but when you have a phase, what you would have, this is a C2, will be then 1/2. And what you will have is A1, so you have the phi which is here. So you have A1 exponential I phi minus 1 plus A2 exponential I phi plus 1. Okay, so you can transform into sine and cosine functions. That's not what I want to do. So what you see is that as soon as phi, when phi is equal to 0, you have only A2. As soon as phi is different from 0, you have a little bit of A1. And this is a signal you measure when you want to measure your phase. Okay? So what you do here, what you can do is a homodyne detections to measure the signal here to have a great sensitivity. So when you have no signal, so when the phase is exactly 0, what you will see here is only vacuum noise coming from here. Okay? So as soon as you have a little bit of signal, so as soon as the phase is slightly different from 0, you start to have a small mean field, but that you will start to see only when it is bigger than the vacuum fluctuation that comes in here. Okay? So the limit of sensitivity of your interferometer, we can do the calculation, but I don't have time for that. You have the limit of sensitivity is when your phase induces a signal which is of the same value as the vacuum fluctuation that comes in. Okay? And so one of the ways to improve the sensitivity is to replace this port here by a squeeze state here, so that you reduce the fluctuations of what you measure. Okay? So that really is the principle of improving a phase measurement with a squeeze state. So you have this, you replace with a squeeze state, and you have a squeeze state that comes in here. Okay? So there are some, yeah? Sorry, yeah. How much squeezing you can get? So the record should be 14 dB now? Just to be 14, yeah. The record of squeezing is 14 dB. And this is actually with people working with what I will come to for gravitational waves. Yeah. But practically, they don't use 14 dB in gravitational waves. It's too much. But I didn't go to know all the details of squeezing, but squeezing can go to very, 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 very small. You start to get problem because squeeze state, in fact, contains photons. So you have extra photons. So you have a limit, but in dB, because it depends on the mean power, so it's a bit hard to say. It's 1 over n to the power 3 or 4 or something like that. I'll have to check the exact number. So you cannot go to infinitely small, but compared to the mean number of photons you have, it gets very, very small. Okay. But you don't go to the equivalent of a Fock state, for instance. This is not, this you don't. Yeah. So first, this equation is not about squeezing, it's just about sensitivity. So this equation just tells you that C2 is equal to A2 when the phase is 0. So when you make a homodyne detection here, what you will see is a noise of A2. And what I just say is that your ground noise in your measurements is a noise of A2. I don't say more than that. Okay? So to improve your measurements, you should change the fluctuation of A2. Okay? And in fact, in practice, if you have classical noise, first you have to reduce the classical noise you have in A2, and then to put some squeezing. Okay? And that's why this has application only to apparatus which are very sensitive when you remove all classical noise, and you can do that. Okay, so then you all know this Michelson interferometer is this one. This is the Virgo one, so the one in Italy. Gravitational wave, I don't introduce, I guess you know that, it's to measure gravitational waves. What is interesting is this curve. I lost the stick here. This curve, so this is the sensitivity curve of a gravitational wave interferometer versus analysis frequency. So the frequency of demodulation of your signal or the output of your homodyne detection. So this is from 2013. So the red curve is the sensitivity of LIGO at that time. So you see there is a crossover at low frequency, it goes up. At high frequency, it goes up. You have a minimum here. And the blue curve is what you have when you use squeeze light. Okay, so this is actual measurements. So they gain a small factor of 2 of sensitivity by using squeeze light, and they gain it only in that side, because in that side the fluctuations they have are really limited by the phase fluctuation of the light. On the other side, you have more complex effect due to the movement of the mirrors and these kind of things. So they only gain into that side when you have an increase of sensitivity. Okay, so just for information, so this is LIGO, but now both LIGO and Virgo have a squeezing inside, so they're actually working. So the two interferometers are running with squeezing. So it's the first practical implementations. You might have heard that last week, at the end of last week, both saw new events, which is a new, the same as before. So two binary stars, two binaries that collapse together. So the same type of event as the first one. So the good news is that these two were detecting with squeezing. The bad news is that the squeezing didn't help at all. So I checked yesterday, asked my colleague, because the frequency, so this is interesting because this curve is still up to date about where it improved. The frequency of these events starts from low frequencies. You know, you have these stars that rotate and accelerate, but it goes as fast as about 250 hertz, so which is something here. And this is where it's very, very marginally improved by the squeeze light. But it was there. At least the squeeze light didn't destroy the sensitivity, which is maybe a great achievement. Yes?
It doesn't improve at low frequency because it's hard to get low frequency squeezing, or is it because it's radiation pressure?
No, it's because you need a squeezing in a different quadrature. Yes. Because indeed here you're limited by intensity noise, mm-hmm. because it's radiation pressure on the mirrors that makes it's limited by intensity noise.
Because the squeezer is like a very low frequency machine.
Yeah, yeah. The squeezer is optimized for that. So of course you have to be a bit careful. I'm not sure how they did here, because you don't want that at low frequency you have increased noise. Okay, so, but, yeah, this I'm not completely sure. Is it just put a high-pass filter or just it works like that? I don't know. We should ask. I can ask and have it the answer for tonight if you want. But ideally, you need quadrature-dependent squeezing to improve all sides. Yeah, you need to rotate the quadratures. I see some of you are, I discussed with one yesterday, working a little bit on that, so should help better. Okay, so this is about squeezing and its application, and there's a lot we could say, but there's different things to say, but that's really one important step for squeeze light. Okay, so now I'd like to move a little bit. I think I've said all of it about that. And move to another tool, once again. Sorry, there are quite a few tools, but things we need. But this is not too hard compared to what we have done before. Because we have been speaking a lot about variances. In fact, there's a tool when you look at noise, which is very convenient, which is a covariance matrix. So the covariance matrix is quite similar to the currency matrix I defined yesterday. But currency matrix was really about annihilation operators. Now I'm looking at quadrature operators. So I have so M is my mode number. So I assume I have a finite mode number. It's easier to write. So now I can define my generalized quadrature operator with two M modes. So it's just the Q operators and the P operators. Then the commutation relation, the same as before, but I can write it in general form that way with this beta matrix, but that's exactly the same as before. The commutation between Q and P is too high, and they do not commute only when they are from the same mode. Okay? And then we define the covariance matrix like that, so which is somehow the mean value of the square. So it's a quadratic system, so it's the second moment of all your operators. So it symmetrizes, so it's xA and B, xB and xA, and when you x can be any of these operators, and you remove the mean value. So it's only about the fluctuations around the mean value. So fluctuation when A equal to B, correlations when A is different from B. And you remove the mean value here. For the rest of the lecture, I will always forget about that. I will always assume that my field has zero mean value. This is not important, it's just like displacing my state. It's really a detail. So it doesn't change anything and just make life easier. So I will always assume that this is zero. Okay? So then, as yesterday, I'm not sure how useful is this, but you can define it in a vectorial way like that. Good? So there's nothing new in the covariance matrix, like we say it. It's just a way to order all my second moment of my field. So look at all the noise. Then you have a few properties. First, you can generalize Heisenberg inequality, so which is the variance of P times the variance of Q is bigger than 1. In that case, what you find, I didn't demonstrate, but we might use, is gamma is my covariance matrix. So gamma plus I beta, where beta is this one, is a positive matrix. Okay, and if you have that, then you satisfy the Heisenberg inequality. Okay, maybe I will show the example in one dimension. But then the covariance matrix of the vacuum. So the vacuum, there's no correlation between P and Q, and the variance, because it satisfies Heisenberg, of each quadrature is 1. So the covariance matrix of the vacuum is simply the identity. Okay, and that's the advantage of the normalization I choose, make it simple. The covariance matrix of the vacuum is the identity. Then one point I will put, so don't, because we might need, but don't need to go too much into details, it's just so that we have it, is how the covariance matrix behaves under basis change. So yesterday, we spent a lot of time in defining what is the basis change, so how define a new set of modes from an old set of modes. I can adapt that to the quadrature operator, so now x become y. Because now it's 2m, of course, not direct. What you see, the matrix you need here has this form, x, y, minus y, x, where x and y are the real and imaginary part of my quadrature operator. Okay, this form comes from the structure of the space. What is interesting is that the way your covariance matrix transforms under basis change, you don't even need to look at the calculation, is simply O gamma, O transpose. Okay, so you have a simple way to calculate your covariance matrix in a new set of modes. Okay, and we might use it depending on the time. Finally, the currency matrix. So this formula inside is really not important, but just to tell you that the currency matrix can be derived from the covariance matrix, meaning that all the information which is in the covariance matrix can be deduced from the covariance matrix. There's no extra information. Okay. So then, of course, covariance matrix contains all the second moment, so it's interesting for Gaussian states. So what are Gaussian states? By definition, Gaussian states are states whose Wigner function is a Gaussian. Okay. So which means that all the measurements you can do on your quadrature will have Gaussian statistics, because this is what a Gaussian Wigner function means, which then induces that your state is fully characterized by its second moment. Okay, that's what a Gaussian is. Then it means that in that case, the covariance matrix contains all the information. Okay, so with a Gaussian state, knowing the covariance matrix is enough to know all your state. And then I will do a few examples, but let me finish on the last properties. The covariance matrix gamma contains all the information, so you can write the Wigner functions as a function of the covariance matrix. And what you have here is simply the inverse of the covariance. And it's a bit like the squeeze state formula we had before. If this is diagonal, it just means I divide by the variance of each term, okay? Because gamma contains the variance. So if gamma is a diagonal matrix, this formula is kind of obvious. This is the 1 over S I had before. I think there might be a 1 half missing. I'll have to check. It's not consistent with what I wrote before. Anyway, it's not that important. Okay? One last formula I might need, the purity. When you have a Gaussian state, the purity of the state can be deduced simply for the covariance matrix is 1 over the square root of the determinant of gamma. Oh, sorry, I wrote that one quick, and I think, yeah, there is a square root here. That's the purity of my Gaussian state. Okay, time is running, but anyway, I think it's good I take a little bit of time on that. I give you 2 examples. Yeah, is it fine? Okay, so let's do 2 examples. If I take a single mode state, if I take a single mode state, then my covariance matrix is quite easy to write. So here you have the variance of Q. Here the variance of P. Here you have 1 half times QP plus PQ with the operators. And here you have the same I don't write it again. Okay? So that's a covariance matrix. So if you look at the Heisenberg inequality I told you, so it's in fact it comes out to be the determinant of that matrix. So it's this times this minus the correlation square, which is bigger than one. That's the usual generalized Heisenberg inequality. If I take a squeezed state, so like the one which is here, for instance, what I get, gamma becomes, well, I've got a variance of S on Q and 1 over S on P. Okay, so remember, the covariance matrix of the vacuum is the identity. The covariance matrix of the current state, I didn't write, but the current state, I explain you, is just a displaced vacuum. So the variance is the same. The covariance matrix of the ground state is also identity. And the one of a squeezed state is just one side is smaller and one side is bigger. Okay? So it's that's why it's a powerful tool, because this is very simple to write your state when you have a squeezed state. I will write it again, but I want to, because the board is small, I want to do one example. So now let me take two squeezed states. Maybe I'll say it again, but I will mix them on a bin splitter. Okay, that's important. I will not have time to do all the details of that, but it's good you have a hint on this kind of state. Okay, so I take two squeezed states, and I take them slightly different. So the first one is a squeezed state which is squeezed like that, like this one here. The second one is squeezed in the other direction. So if I look at the covariance matrix of this state, so remember it's a Q1, Q2, P1, P2. It's organized like that. So the first state is Q1 is S. The second one is the opposite direction. So I take 1 over S. I assume they have the same squeezing. It makes my life easier. And then I have 1 over S here and S here. And all the rest are zeros. This is still a diagonal matrix, which is two squeezed states. So S1S is my first mode, and 1 over SS is the second mode. It's two squeezed states, but squeezed in orthogonal directions. Okay? Then, what is the covariance matrix after the beam splitter? So, I had mode, maybe I can, well, A1, A2. I will put prime here, it will be easier because I don't have new notation for Q and P. So if I write Q1 prime, and Q2, which one should I write? Let's write Q2 prime here. Q1 minus Q2. I don't do it for P, it's exactly the same. Q and P follow the same relations. So I didn't demonstrate, but the Q and P, like A and B, they follow the same beam splitter relations as the electric field, because at the end of the day, they are electric fields. So now what is my covariance matrix prime? So I will not do all the calculations, but I can do one. If I calculate the variance of Q1 prime here, what is it? Well, the variance of Q1 prime is, so these two beams are not correlated. So the variance of the sum is the sum of the variances. So this is simply 1/2 times the variance of Q1, which is S, plus 1 over S. Okay? So I will call that sigma. Makes it easier. And I have the same for Q2 prime. Okay? And now if I look also at the product Q1 prime times Q2 prime, what I have mean value of Q1 squared, the same, Q2 squared, the same, and the cross are zero. And in fact, you find also sigma. So now if I look at my covariance matrix, it's Q1 prime, Q2 prime, P1 prime, P2 prime. What I have is the variance of Q1 prime is sigma, of Q2 prime is sigma, but of the correlation is sigma also. And here I've got zero, because because I don't have a QP correlations, and here I've got the same, sigma, 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 sigma. Okay, so this is my coherence matrix after the beam splitter. So the question is, what kind of state is that? Here. So I guess you might know, at least from what you have heard, but you don't see it from here, this is an entangled state. So first, you know, you send a single photon on the beam splitter, I get entangled photons. This is kind of the same. So why is this an entangled state? Because if I look at the correlations, okay, so if I look at the correlations between Q1 prime and Q2 prime, okay, so if I look at Q1 prime, but they are correlated. This is what it means here. This is the correlation. So this beam or the output are highly correlated. And this is a pure state. So because it's a pure state and you have correlations, they are quantum correlations. Okay? So it's not a big demonstration, just to give you a hint about that. You have correlation at the output, you have a pure state, there are quantum correlations. Another way to see, that's why I like this, of course, remember, there are square root, but if I look at the purity of my matrix, so it didn't change, it's still one. But now you can calculate the purity, you can calculate the matrix gamma 1 prime, so for the submod 1, okay, and this one, I have to be careful, but I just take the terms that corresponds to 1. It's a Q1 prime and P1 prime, and I have sigma 0, 0, sigma. Okay? Now if I look at the determinant of that, it's sigma squared. Okay? So the purity now is much smaller than 1. Okay? So this state has a low purity, and this state has a low purity. And you should know, if you have a pure state and the subspaces are not pure, it means you have entanglement. Okay? That's for pure state, it's a very good criteria of entanglement. So these two states are entangled. So the beam splitter does the entanglement. Okay? And then obviously, I could go on and make another beam splitter, and I can remove my entanglement. And this is really one of the main messages of this lecture, is that through beam splitter, you can change the nature of your state from separated pure states with states to entangled and go back. Okay? Yes, sure.
We just go back to the single mode covariance matrix. So what would be the meaning of off-diagonal element where I have a QP element? Is that the single mode, yes?
Yes, you mean off-diagonal element?
Yes.
So squeeze state, I don't have off-diagonal elements.
Yeah, but what would be the meaning if I would now add some off-diagonal elements? So what would happen to this state?
So it just means you have correlations between Q and P. So if you have a pure state, what you can show is there's always a direction, always a Q and Q theta, where you can remove these correlations. And this, in fact, I want to comment. Takes much more time than expected, but you can always, via rotation of Q and P, diagonalize your covariance matrix. So there's always a basis where it's written like that. It's exactly that. Okay, so this would mean that you have a squeezing which doesn't angle. Okay. But your covariance matrix can, if for pure state, can always be written like that. Okay, so it's just a squeezing angle. Okay, so I have 1 minute left, is it? So that's not much. No, because there was two more things I wanted to do, but well, I guess I'll do this afternoon and we'll see how much time. Just then I can show you, these people have done, and so there's many articles about that. I like this one, maybe it's because I know the Python, but it's also because it's a clear one, it's not at all the first one. But they really take the two squeeze states, they mix on the beam splitter, and what is nice is that they add losses here, so they look how this behave versus losses, and they display this kind of curve. So this is the entanglement criteria you measure here as a function of losses. So when you have no losses, you have some entanglement, which really is equivalent to the squeezing at the input, and the entanglement reduces when you have more losses. And the second curve is a different criteria of entanglement, which is a conditional variance one, which is more like a QND for those that know that, or steering-like inequalities. I don't comment entanglement criteria, I have no time, but you can have a look at that. It's a very complicated domain to look at entanglement continuous variables, especially when you don't have pure state. When you have pure state, all of this is quite clear. When you don't have, when you start putting losses, you have as many criteria as experimentalists, because you use the ones that work for your experiment, which is always the one. And with this, I will then stop and we'll continue this afternoon. So that's a good question. If you do, I assume you don't do that, if you do with the same direction. If I calculate my variance here, now my two beams, Q1 and Q2, have the same variance. So here the variance of Q1 will not be sigma, but will be S. I will be back. So in fact, if I take the two beams with the same direction, or the output, I have also two squeeze states. So I don't have entanglement. Okay. So really, it's a surprising fact now. If you have two squeezing the same directions, the beam filter doesn't do anything. If they have orthogonal directions, then it makes entanglement. Okay. More questions? Coffee? Coffee.